Hello, viewer, and welcome to Spotlight here on Hope TV, where you look and live. And on Spotlight, we always do our very best to bring to you persons who are impacting our community in the direction of light and how much we need that. And one of the things that is always big on our list of things is money. You know, talk about money and everyone just want to hear what you have to say. I mean, give out money, whatever amount it is, and you'll have a rush of people coming to take it up. I mean, lots of headaches in the city and in the countryside. And if you look at all those headaches, most of them are about money. And so money is an important subject for each one of us. And we are going to be engaging Money Matters on this edition of Spotlight. And we are so happy and honored, privileged to have with us Amos Ngahu, who is the director of, guess what, the Money Clinic, to be with us here on Spotlight. Welcome, Amos.
Thank you so much.
Money.
Asante sana.
You know, how we're glad to have you.
Yeah, thank you, thank you.
You know, I like the name of your institution, the Money Clinic, you know? And when you talk about clinic, you imagine people just lined up outside, you know, to see the doctor, right? And so we are happy to have you here on Spotlight, and welcome.
Thank you.
I know this is your first time on Spotlight here, so
yes.
we are happy, and I'm sure that you'll be back, because money, big subject. You know what Jesus said?
Yeah.
Jesus said that you cannot serve money and mammon.
Yes.
I mean, you cannot serve God and mammon.
Yeah.
A big statement there, you know, and you are always dealing with money, right?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about you, faith and money, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'm really honored to be here. Mm-hmm. And like you said, in case they didn't get the name, is Amos Ngahu. Mm-hmm. A lot of people have a challenge pronouncing it. Mm-hmm. And I run a company called Money Clinic. And out of Money Clinic, there's a program I run called Money Gossip. And people may have come across it on TikTok, and I just share nuggets about money. Mm-hmm. And it's a very interesting discussion, because when you now try to look at money in Christianity, mm-hmm. I must say, this is my 16th year doing what I do, the people who are struggling the most mostly are Christians. Mm. We are struggling with this issue of money. And one of the things I can say is that one nature of money is it's amoral. Mm-hmm. It's neither good nor bad. But what you do with it is what now will either be determined as good or bad. And it's a very interesting thing, because when you look at the Bible, it has various characters. And I like giving two examples. I like when you see Solomon. Solomon asked for wisdom, but he ended up probably being still the richest man the world has ever seen. And all of us want to be, you know, like Solomon, but we don't know the price he paid to be there. Mm-hmm. We also, in the same creation, we have Lazarus. And I'm not talking about the one who died. We are talking about this guy who ate from what fell off from the rich man's table. That guy in his entire life was never wealthy, but he served the purpose of God. And to show its significance, the rich man, we've never been told the name. And you're a man of cloth, so you might tell us if we have ever been told the name.
Well, he's just called that.
Yeah, so yes. I like relating. Anything else will be added. But if we can be able to find more what God has in store for us, because that path, once you find it, it's easy to deal with money because you know where you're going. And so for me, when it comes to money and faith, it really has to do with a lot of discipline, stewardship, and especially knowing what you've been called to do.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, you make some interesting observations there.
Yeah.
One of them is that as you are engaging people on money matters in your money clinic, that you do find people of faith really struggling on this front.
Yes.
Are there some unique challenges you find that people of faith have when it comes to money?
Well, it is one major thing that really strikes out is for you to be able to understand that, I explained the one quality or the one characteristic of money, of it being immoral. Mm-hmm. So you want to associate, you still want to be a Christian, but you want to take shortcuts You've not controlled your greed for money. Mm-hmm. You've not controlled the, you know, you're not a good steward. You want to live this kind of a lifestyle. You don't understand that there are limits. So that kind of a lifestyle, and you'll find it's easier. Even when I do some of my events and I advertise all over, people come from across religions. Mm-hmm. You find people from all over. But the Christians are the ones that will really struggle in certain ways.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, and when you say that money is immoral, meaning that it's neither good nor bad, it can go either way.
Yes.
And that's an interesting perspective because there is a whole school of living that sees money as evil.
Yes.
Actually, there is this line, maybe famous infamous, that money is the root of all evil, you know? And that tends to... again, push your immoral description, you know, towards the dark, right?
Yeah.
I mean, just tell us this. As you talk about money being immoral, as compared to money being evil, what does it make a difference the way you understand money?
Now, I love that question because just like there are other general personalities that are dominant in people, there is what we call money personalities. So the major ones are spenders, people who like spending a lot of money. Then there are hoarders, people who are a bit stingy. Mm. But there are two more that are not, they're not with a lot of people. And one of them is money monks. We call them money monks. Money monks based on a culture that has been instilled in them, either the way they've been brought up or ascribing to a certain religion, I'll use quote and quote because some of them are cultic, you realize that this person has grown knowing that money is evil. So even if they earn something or they've been given a gift, let's say I decide to buy you lunch, you'll find that person finding it very difficult to receive money from you. And sometimes they deny you an opportunity to be a giver. You understand? And these people will take a very long time to release that kind of notion that it is okay. It is actually God who gives us ability to make money. So based on that characteristic or that personality, you'll find people will really avoid issues to do with money. We have seen some. You remember, I think it was around 2011, a certain church somewhere, they were told, I mean, the world is ending, sell or give out your stuff and get into a bunker. I don't know if it has happened to them, but you get what I'm saying. So people will be taken advantage of. So you'll find people are just, you know, avoiding money and they've been told money is bad and they're able to avoid that particular subject. So it's a personality and sometimes it can be a season.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, when you're at that, because it's an interesting thing, you know, you're giving us an education here about money personality.
Yes.
Can you, you've talked about money monks.
Yes.
Tell us about the other money personalities that
there are. Yeah, I'll also do the second one that is rare. This is what we call money avoiders. And money avoiders is basically people who do not want or are not interested in a conversation about money. And all of us have been in that season. And I'll give an example. This happens to men a lot of times. And in these hard economic times, you'll find probably you did your shopping. Today is 30th, isn't it? So probably you were paid on 25th, you did your shopping, you did everything you were given. But then today you're in traffic heading home, and you're told, babe, diapers imeisha. What's the first reaction? And you know you don't have money.
Yeah.
You get angry.
Yeah.
You don't want that conversation about money.
No, we've been there.
And you're wondering, So you become, you don't want to have that discussion because you don't have that resource. And that's what you'll find even along, let's say like Mbagathi, when you find guys walking in the morning across Mbagathi all the way to South Sea to industrial area. So this person is living from hand to mouth. So you cannot call them for a seminar about finances. They'll ask you, where is the money you get? So they will avoid anything to do with finances. Those are money avoiders. And then now we have the two general ones, which is spenders and hoarders. So spenders, I'm a spender actually. We believe that anything good was meant for us. You know, we believe that we our resources, our money is meant to make people happy. But when we don't have it, again, our spirits are low. Okay, and then you find the hoarders. Hoarders are those guys who are always making the office microwave smell what they ate last night because they carry lunch to work. And these people are people who will tell you, I'm saving to build to buy a house. but a spender will risk borrow, even if they are not sure they will afford it to get the house.
Yeah. So I think I'm a holder. I think holding.
Yeah.
You know, I think yeah. I am that. Yeah.
But however, we can possess all this, but it is one that is major,
mm-hmm.
because you realize there are some areas that you'll be generous. There are some areas that you'll not be generous. Okay, to ladies, you'll find they are spenders when emotions are attached.
Mm-hmm.
A lady will even, on a small salary, if she has a son who's struggling to find a job, she will get a loan to get the son to start a business, which is not a very good idea, okay? But now, in other areas, she can be a hoarder, okay? But a man will, if the men are getting together, they will want to show who has, can flex, you know, bigger. So you'll find a bill will be paid by one man. So
yeah, people who doesn't have money worries, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
But in the same thing, when he gets to the house because he feels like people are overspending, he will be a little bit of a hoarder.
Okay.
So we possess general aspects of the form.
All right.
Yes.
Now that you are a man of faith, you are also a man of money.
Yes.
Let me call you that.
Yes.
You hear sometimes in spaces of faith.
Yes.
If somebody says, for instance, a pastor says, I really want to make a lot of money. I want to make a lot of money. I mean,
yes.
It sounds like something is wrong
yes.
with that. Can you speak about making a lot of money,
yes.
especially in a Christian context?
Yes. Let me put it this way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not very old. I'm so excited that I'm turning 40. So if I tell you...
Life just beginning.
..is about to begin.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll tell you what. If I tell you I want to travel this year, that is one statement. But if I tell you I want to visit Asia... Are you seeing the difference between those two statements? One is specific.
Mm-hmm.
Being rich is not a goal. And I get worried, especially a lot of young people, when they tell me, I want to be rich.
And that's a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot of young people.
A lot of people, they want... In fact, there was a research saying that about 70% of Kenyan youth don't mind making wealth through hook or crook.
Mm-hmm.
I get worried.
They can sanitize later.
They can
money first, sanitization later.
And of course, mm-hmm. we have perfect examples in a society today.
Mm.
But when I look at it, I try to approach, and this is the foundation of my mentorship on money, on coaching. You see, we quote Philippians 4:13, and we say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You being a study, having studied the Bible, when you read the entire chapter, you get the context under which I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because Paul is telling the Philippians, listen, I'm not saying this because I have plenty. Okay? I'm saying this because through lack and through plenty, I have learned the art of contentment. Please mm-hmm. note that. Through lack, through plenty,
mm-hmm.
I have learned the art of contentment. Therefore,
mm-hmm.
I can do all things through Christ who strengthens
mm-hmm.
me. So I get, when I try to sit with people and they tell me I want to be rich, I'm interested in your story. What story do you want to
mm-hmm.
build? My, like I shared with you earlier, my son is turning 10. And I normally say, if I cannot explain what I do for a living to him, then I've failed.
Mm.
And I tell people, without your story, money is useless. You must attach a story. See how you've built. This is how I built my world. So around it, when people say, I want to be rich, I want to make a lot of money, for me, my goal is to help, and this is so disappointing to so many people, my work is not to help people get rich. My help is to prepare them for all seasons.
Mm.
When the season is good, when you're planting, just the normal seasons, when you're planting, when you're harvesting, when you've sold your produce and you're now furrowing the ground. And it becomes very exciting because you prepare everybody for all the seasons.
You know, and because you've talked about all seasons, we know we are in a tough season right now, but we'll talk about that.
Yes.
Let's first get through some things. You mentioned that God gives us power to make wealth, right? Sometimes we find that in the Christian circles, you find that there's a lot of emphasis on power to be transformed, like from... a person who is like struggling with alcohol to a person who is sober.
Yes.
It's power to do that. We'll talk about power to exorcise demons, for instance. You know, cast out demons, you know. We'll talk about power to get us to heaven, to sustain us to heaven. But there's a power we don't usually talk about.
Yes.
The power to make wealth.
Yes.
We hardly will hear that power emphasized.
Yeah.
Can you just balloon that? Tell us about the beauty of the power to make wealth from a Christian understanding.
Well, it gets really exciting because even when I was coming here, my first point of contact was the security guards. Mm-hmm. Now, if you don't smile at them, even if they don't block you from entering, you will take some time there. And as you come in, of course, there's people at the reception, and then I was able to meet your producer, and now I'm here. What I'm trying to say is there are functions. There is a place for every Christian. There is a role. Okay? Once we take up that role and we accept it and we know this is my calling, this is what I've been called to do, he provides. And what I tell people is I don't qualify to be doing what I'm doing right now. I'm actually doing my undergrad in marketing, BCom, in Strathmore University. And this passion came out of when I was working in a company and would lose clients because they made decisions that were rushed. So you sit down and you're able to sit with them and you're able to help them plan. So it is not even what we did in school. It's about you serving a certain purpose. So when we say the ability and the power to make wealth, I am not a billionaire. You'll not find me in the Forbes magazine. But I believe there are people who actually touch something and it turns. And everybody has that ability. But listen, God is not interested in making you all that money, then he loses you. He's weighing on your stewardship. He's weighing on your accountability. He's weighing on how he can work with you to make a difference. And that is why if you want to be a billionaire, there are certain things. You know, as a Christian, things are different for you, you know, from being an un-Christian. And I believe we should enjoy the journey because if you are born into a rich, you know, palace and you had all the wealth, would you have a story to give? You wouldn't. But you see, building it, I actually say that it's based on your purpose. And the moment you align to it, he provides. That one I can guarantee you.
Okay.
Yes.
No, I like that. I like the fact that God is very interested, not so much in building your bank account so much as he is interested in your stewardship, such that your wealth is purposeful.
Yes.
Now, you mentioned also young people, because this should be it's a cultural thing that if you are broke, you know, then, I mean, it's a sin. Being broke is actually in the category of sins. And it affects everything. It affects your self-esteem. It affects so many things. You know, you are all the way down, right? And it's so much so for the younger generation who want to be rich quickly, you know? And so they get into all manner of, you know, gambling, for instance. They get into kind of, you know, hard, you know, like, under the table deals, and what they talk about is not how they got it, but the money they got, right? And how does one speak to this generation of young people and just piss them out?
It's the program that I ran called Money Gossip. It was because of a few young guys who told me we don't have that money. So I told them we still talk about money, but in its absentia. So that's why we want to gossip about it.
And that's interesting.
There are so many things I've learned from these young people. The way we used to handle them no longer works. They observe. They will copy. They will influence each other. Don't forget the power of social media. So the question, first of all, we need to ask them, because these guys are very intelligent. Engage them and ask them questions. One of the questions I ask them is, who determines if you're broke? Because you are the only one who knows you're broke. Who determines? How do you, what makes you think you're broke? And some of them are not. It's only that now the comparison to what is happening on social media, to what is happening around who bought what, in what, who is going where. And that alone has worked against them so much that we have a very huge number of young people listed negatively in CRB.
Mm-hmm.
The last time I was here on Swahili News, there was a report that you guys shared. I was also shocked that a lot of these lending apps, and especially was it Fuliza? It was mm-hmm. actually in the public domain, that they lend more on Fridays from 3 p.m. It was during COVID to 9 p.m. That's in the afternoon, late in the afternoon and evening. Mm-hmm. That's Friday. You want to tell me, guys, these guys go to Gikomba that particular time to buy mtumba to come and sell? This is what they're doing with their money. Mm-hmm. So the challenge is comparison. And not unless you show them the dangers of comparison, those people, by the time they're getting to 30 and 40, they'll have introduced a very bad culture mm-hmm. of living off debt. And you forget that even the limits that you have on digital platforms is not your money.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where they are going. And that's a very big danger, because over time, now they will not be able to progress. And they will forever learn to survive on debt, which mm-hmm. is a very dangerous thing for the youth.
Okay.
Yes.
And so from where you sit, there's a parent who is listening to you.
Mm.
And they really want to know how they can be able to engage mm-hmm. Their teenage children, for instance, or their college-going, you know, children on money matters.
Yes.
So what are some of the things you tell the parents to either culture mm-hmm. or caution or, teach?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that opportunity. I've been waiting for an opportunity to address parents, especially those who have teenagers all the way to the age of our parents.
Mm-hmm.
And they have been the problem. As parents, we have been the problem. The moment, because I've grown up, my dad told me he never wore shoes. And they used to, when they're going to school, I hope he's listening. When they used to go to school, they used to carry even the, you know, remember those aluminium jerry cans for milk? And he goes with it to school. So he never had shoes. So his purpose was for us to have a better, not to go through the challenges he had. Eh? And then over time, us, because we wore shoes, now we also want to improve the quality, not just our kids to go to, we don't want them to go to public school, we want them to go to private schools. All for who? For ourselves.
Mm.
And that is where you'll find we have teenagers, because I've related, I've sat with even, I've even studied with some of these 20 to 25-year-olds, and they're incredibly smart. But they are always spoon-fed. When your kid goes to campus, let them move out. Let them get a one room somewhere. Let even start in Mathare. Let them harden. Let them grow. Let them build their own story. But you find, at 25, you've graduated. You're still with me in my house. You're not building them. So we need to let our kids make mistakes, but with the caution that we need. We tell them, by the way, you're going to fall off the cliff. That's it. But now you find someone calls you, hey, my son is looking for a job. Okay. Now, because he didn't find, I've taken a loan. I'm talking about a real case. I've taken a loan to open for him a barber shop. And then you tell me 6 months, hey, it has collapsed. I'm not surprised, because you're trying to take the role of God in your son's life or in your daughter's life. So one of the things I'll tell parents is take a back seat. Don't rush them to do medicine. Because your neighbor or the cousin is doing medicine. Let them stay. You remember the year we used to stay out before we go to campus?
Mm-hmm.
Let them go to a construction site. Let them go to your business. Let them go to, you know, look for manual work. Let us teach them the value of work. Tell them what you're doing. I'll not give you pocket money, but I'll pay campus. Learn to work for it. Because once you don't, I served in the children's ministry, and I'll tell you one thing. I learned that children are adults in small bodies. They copy everything you tell them. And if you don't teach a sense of ownership, you're teaching a sense of entitlement.
Mm.
So whatever they are doing, let them earn their money, let them be held accountable.
Wow.
Yeah.
I think parents are listening. And I'm sure that there are some people who are not looking at each other right now as they hear that. Because... Even when it comes to parenting style, sometimes there's a whole conflict.
Yes.
Because one will want the children to be comfortable.
Yes.
The other will want the children to I mean, just fight it out for themselves. And yes. So even parental relationships sometimes yes. are conflicted around how they create responsibility in their children.
Yes.
Now, just before we go for a break, I want to stay with young people a little bit because in the midst of the culture of young people wanting to be rich quickly and not caring about the means and all that, there still is a crop that would stand out,
yes.
right? Mm. Stand out in that they are diligent, stand out in that they are conscious of all their, you know, what they're doing in terms of money, right? Mm. Can you tell us a little bit about this young people who stand out in terms of wealth creation?
I feel like the first thing they need to do is build on something.
Mm.
And I'm not talking about tenderpreneurs. I'm talking about if you're, today everybody's doing content creation and you feel like you have a certain talent, invest in it. Invest in information. I really get excited when I run my programs and I find 22, 23-year-olds because now they're able to work on something. Associate yourself with people who are way ahead of you, who prove that there's really nothing to fear. Some of my programs are organized by these young people who work for me. The event for Money Gossip, they do posters, they run my social media page. Build on something. One of them came to me, he just followed me on social media and he told me, please follow my page and like my content.
Mm.
So I followed and he does talks here and there. So he thought I was young until I told him, called me. And I told him, my friend, I've been in this business for 16 years. And I told him, I'm so excited because you're 22. Once we work together, you'll be able to grow and probably grow faster at a faster rate than I have, isn't it? Because by the time my son is 20 to take over what I do, it's gonna time will be gone. Mm. And I'm not sure if he'll take over because I see he's interested in something else. Because that's how we build succession. And eventually they can grow in their patience to become something bigger. So I feel like, one, associate yourself with people who are way ahead. And most importantly, and this is the bottom line.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be patient.
Mm.
There's no overnight success.
Wow, patience.
Yes.
You know, when you talk about patience, it's one of the things that, one of the values that yes. This generation and this contemporary times actually mock, you know, because we want things right away,
yes.
you know? If you
Instant.
Are, if things are delaying, then you're doing something wrong, right?
Yes.
We are going to take a short break. And when we come back, viewer, we will be talking about the times we're living in, times that have been described as difficult times with the prices going in the wrong direction. And we have a political season that, is also very difficult, making it difficult for many businesses. And in the midst of all this, there's the whole area that we don't really like, the area of debt. Mm. And we want to engage that. This is Spotlight. We're taking a short break. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Liven up your day with this Southern Gospel favorite.
Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our
The Bill Gaither Show, featuring veteran gospel artists. The Gaither Vocal Band.
And I know, yes I know.
Homecoming series, interviews, and much more. The show only on Hope TV.
Join us every Sunday for Unlimited. uplifting, powerful worship. Only on Extended Worship.
Because women talk more and they are not very strong physically, when they want to hurt their husbands or their children or anybody, they use the tongue.
Families under God.
How can we continue to live carelessly in ease?
Join Reverend Dr. Judy Mbugua as she imparts families through prayer, evangelism, and social transformation with the Word of God.
You know, God is not asking you to manage. He's asking you to be available.
Amen.
And He will make you able and capable.
Families Under God, Sundays at 8:30 p.m. only on Hope TV. Hope TV is now available on GoTV Channel 103, Zuku Channel 873, Signet Channel 817 and Star Times Channel 026. Enjoy our uplifting content and family-friendly programming anytime. Hope TV, you look and live.
Viewer, welcome back. This is Spotlight, and we are talking to Amos Ngahu, who is the director of the Money Clinic. And we are talking money matters, especially in the times that we are experiencing right now. And one of the things that you mentioned was, just before even for the break, is that we have to be patient.
Yes.
Now, you know, I was reading somewhere that the right away of 1970...
Yeah.
Is not the right away of 1980.
Yes.
Is not the right away of 1990.
Yes.
Is not the right away of 2022. Yes. It's like things keep getting more urgent. The right away becomes more and more urgent. Yes. And so when you talk about patience, I mean, who are you speaking to?
You know, if and this comes out clearly,
mm-hmm.
Are you a sports fan?
Oh yeah.
I've been an Arsenal fan, unashamedly for a very long time. And they no longer make them the way they used to make Thierry Henry.
Mm-hmm.
They never make them anymore like the way Ronaldo looks like. And this is what is happening. When you look at the sportsmen of today, comparing to the LeBron James and the Ronaldos who are still playing in their late 30s, is because these people started from very humble background.
Mm-hmm.
Ronaldo, if you read his story, where he came from, LeBron James. But now the current breed went to academies, soccer academies in France, in Italy. So they know they are talented, we agree. They are super athletic, we agree. But mentally, it's been proven that they are weaker than the earlier sports people. Why? The same thing we are talking about. The level of patience. How do you start with a salary of of millions of euros? And I'm just 19. So I don't know how to wait. And this is why you'll find now when they're getting to 25, 26, when other younger ones are coming, it's hard for them to relate. It's hard for them to relate with the outside world. So that's the whole challenge. We need to inculcate the power of patience, working, you know, on something small. A lot of us have tried even construction when we started out. You try telling a university, you know, guy to do construction, they won't do it. But so they don't understand the value of patience, which is very important because life in itself, it's a requirement. You have to be patient. So for me, it's really sad that we have a generation that is very creative, very energetic, but very impatient.
And for you to make good money and make good wealth.
Yes.
A positive wealth, then patience is inevitable.
For them, they don't have a problem making money.
Mm-hmm.
For you to sustain it, you need the patience.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And even make it in the right way.
Yes,
you know?
Make it the right
way. And You know, this season is a hard season because there are lots of interferences that are making our economic life more and more difficult. You know, we have prices going up. We have so many things going up. And so you find that your money is really thinning. We just came from COVID, and COVID really drained lots of resources. Yes. And people are just building up. And then as you build up, then there are these now other interferences, these pressures. Now, can you describe to us exactly what's going on at this time from your money experience, from your day-to-day engagement, Amos? What's going on?
Now, I've seen something, and it's hard to see. Mm-hmm. For an average eye. The other day we had a lot of motorbikes impounded because they messed up a lady. Was that the first incident? They've done it before. That has been the norm. Mm-hmm. Now we are looking at them. Those guys are on survival mode. If you see the shortcut they will take, let's say a roundabout is up there, but they are risking, probably they will save fuel worth 20 bob. But they will risk their lives to do a U-turn in the wrong place. And if we look at ourselves, when things are tight, we go on survival mode. Mm-hmm. Now, survival mode, we feel like, yes, we've made it today. But what is the future damage we have caused? Up here in Ngong Road, nowadays, because the schools are closed, you will find a 10-year-old, 11-year-old, not even knocking at your window, coming to peep and demanding 10 shillings. What are you doing to the future of that child? Mm-hmm. Are we seeing the damage that we're doing? Mm-hmm. And we get into survival mode. So a lot of us, without knowing, there's something we are doing. We feel like, yes, I'll survive today. Okay? There's something I'm compromising in my business. I'm not doing ETRs. Okay? To compromise and maximize on return. What am I doing in the long run is a damage that sometimes can run for generations. And that is what you'll find in our economy today. People are on survival mode. They will compromise on everything. We've had several exposés on illegal goods or things that have been manufactured in Kariobangi, a health hazard, just because that person needs to make an income. Mm-hmm. So we must look at it as a bigger picture and see the damage that we are doing to our people. Mm-hmm. What that little action that you're doing, that mishandling of people that you're doing to just make an income, that survival mode is very dangerous. Mm-hmm. And that is what is happening in our economy today. Everybody, they say in Swahili, mwamba ngoma wivuta kwake. Everybody is pulling them. How many MCAs do you know that are vying in your ward? 100 of them, you know, but only one will succeed. Mm. Everybody's looking at politics and seeing how I can make a difference. So the thing is,
how can make money?
Yeah, how I can make a difference in my finances.
Yes.
And that is why you'll find we don't need to panic. You need to understand that I can adjust accordingly based on what is happening. Mm-hmm. Because history repeats itself. Go back to the times of Joseph. He told them there would be 7 years of drought and 7 years of plenty. Mm. So what are we doing in the 7 years? We're just patient and spending little by little. Because is this the last time? During COVID, I told people, this COVID will go away, but this is not the end of hard times. Mm. In fact, what COVID does, or hard economic times, what they do, they expose our weak side of poor planning. They expose our weak side of not looking ahead. Because I normally, is actually Warren Buffett who says that chains of habit cannot be felt. Mm-hmm. They're too easy, they're too light to be felt until they're too difficult to be broken. Mm. So you realize they're difficult now. The poor habits you've been having, enjoying all your money without setting something for the rainy day, without having that passive income that you're growing, do you feel it now?
Now, you've mentioned two things there. You've mentioned a passive income.
Yes.
You've mentioned saving.
Yes.
Maybe you can tell the viewer some of the things, because everyone is looking for a solution. Mm. I mean, how do I make it through this time?
Yes.
Businesses are looking at how do I make it through this political season?
Yes.
Of course, there's another side that is really making a lot of money for the same season.
Yes.
But let's look at the ones who are hard-pressed.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the businesses and the individuals. What do they do?
I normally don't have a one-size-fits-all mm-hmm. kind of a solution.
Mm-hmm.
Because like I shared, we have many personalities. Let's approach them from the point of the two major personalities. So you'll find for hoarders, they don't have a problem with saving. But if this, what they have is little, is too little to even save, okay, there's no money that is too small to invest. You can always reduce your expenses. Then they can go ahead and reduce their expenses and see how they can start something to supplement their income. And for such guys, we look for investments for them that is safe, that can be able to meet their recurrent expenses. So for instance, if you have your rent, if you have your school fees, how can we tailor make an investment that will take care of the school fees passively?
Mm-hmm.
Now, for money spenders, sometimes it looks like it's easier, slightly easier for them to make money because of their people skills. If for instance, I know you golf every Wednesday, so I'll pay for my membership to make sure I get into contact with you and you see the kind of work I do, and it makes it easier for me to do business. But for a holder, we'll see like the club membership is too expensive, so I'll just wait. You now get the picture. So for spenders, it's very important for you to know that you must bring your cost down, that nobody really cares where you live. You know, there are times that you need to scale down. There are times that you can actually survive on what you're doing. So it's important for us to know how do we handle this.
Mm-hmm.
For spenders, it is okay to reduce on your expenses. For hoarders, it is also okay for you to see how you can be able to generate a passive income and grow your business skills. Because, mm-hmm. and this is something that is very sad. Did you see that a lot of people during COVID is when they started their businesses? Things they had been procrastinating because they were comfortable with their salaries. I know like a guy called Lame, I think he's called Lame on TikTok. He lost his job during COVID. And right now he's worth about, I think he's grown to about $1.5 million worth because of he was pushed to do something.
Mm.
We don't have to wait for problems to push us.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Okay.
We don't have to wait. You don't have to wait for yourself to lose that job. And especially for men. For men, by the time you're 35, you need to start looking at an active plan for your retirement.
Mm.
Because a lot of men are retiring, but because they don't have anywhere to go, wanashinda pale kwa kale ka shopping center kwa ka hotel.
Mm, mm.
You understand this?
You know, yeah. When you're at that, they say also that if you look carefully at hard times, even the ones we are in right now, yes. you'll find an opportunity there.
Yes.
You know, because sometimes we're so conscious of the pain and mm-hmm. The suffocation and,
yes.
and the lack
yeah.
that we don't, our mind does not tune to the opportunity.
Yeah.
Now, in this season that, I mean, economics, the national economics seem to just be harsh on the citizen.
Mm.
I mean, what tell us about turning our minds on to opportunity.
I'll tell you what, I was surprised that as much as we say that oil has gone up, there are people who are not even concerned about cooking oil. They use olive oil
mm-hmm.
or canola oil or more expensive oil because that's what they know. They are not feeling the pain at all. If you look at our exports, if you look at our car markets today, if these high-end cars are still selling, they're still meeting their targets because they're people with money. And a good percentage also have made money in a legitimate way. So the thing should be, and this is where now faith comes in.
Mm-hmm.
You can see problems. And if you use this approach, I've seen a lot of people developing solutions for an existing problem, work on it, fine-tune it, and sell the solution. There's always someone ready to buy your solution. Okay? There are times I have sat and I've asked myself, is this what I've really been called to do?
Mm.
Until you post a video, someone hears you there, they're like, wow, my life has changed.
Mm.
You understand? So a lot of us, even Dr. Miles Monroe, if you've read some of his books, he says an average human being has above 500 different talents and abilities, all with abilities to make money. So it's up to us to start focusing, because sometimes, and I'll say this with a lot of confidence, your job can be a distraction. You know?
Mm-hmm.
Your status can be a distraction. I tell celebrities, especially these athletes, your career has the shortest about it. Your fans will not convert into money, so you have to think ahead and see how you can grow it. Because let me tell you something, the problem today is not shortage of ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Because either we have too many distractions or we are not emotionally competent.
Mm.
Yes.
You know, yeah, that's like itself a big, it's like a black hole.
Yes.
You know, emotional competence.
Yes.
And that's a whole subject by itself. Let me talk about something that you may loop in, mm-hmm. the emotional competence.
Yes.
Because these difficult times, the opportunities also of getting into debt, thick debt,
mm-hmm.
you know, are also very high. And
yes.
also it's debt that you can excuse,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
There's no other way, right? Amos, what do we do? Because sometimes people go through these, you know, loops of debt. When they're just about to come out, you're back in. Can you speak to that?
I'll say this. You mm-hmm. can never borrow your way out of poverty. No way. If anything, and I tell people sometimes, it's a statement that people are asking me, what are you talking about?
Mm-hmm.
I told them, sometimes if you're listed in CRB, that could be the best thing that has happened to you if you've been listed negatively. Because sometimes when you're rolling downhill, sometimes even stopping is making progress. So I tell people, number one, get that right. No economy, even economies, has ever borrowed itself out of poverty. And if it's debt that you're taking, take debt that can help you grow, not consumption debt.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things I tell people, and this is a majority of Kenyans, the digital lending apps that were there, it's only 30% that take them for construction, 70% is for investments and business, 70% is consumption. Now, this is what happens, and this is going to touch a raw nerve. I'm touching a raw nerve here, especially with parents. You continue to borrow to take your kids to school because they can't go to a day school. You want them to go to a more expensive school. You borrow, they have left, they've gone to campus. You've borrowed, and all you have is a home to stay in. And they are gone and you have retired. Guess what you start doing? You're forcing them to pay black tax. They are now you're now depending on your children.
Mm.
And what is happening? You start saying, my kids, oh, my kids are. One of the biggest challenges that we have today is black tax. Parents depending on their children. And I'll challenge men. If you're a father, if you have a family, okay, give the basic education. Stop focusing on just an inheritance for your children. I think your retirement should be given a priority so that your children can build their own. Give them direction. A lot of people here are self-made. Okay? You're denying your child to be self-made. You're denying your child a story. So whether things are thick, it is okay to move from high end or the suburbs to a place. If you've lost your job, move to the village for 6 months. You know, go to the mountains. This is the time that you go to pray and look for solutions.
What about image?
Let me tell you something.
Image is big.
Let me tell you something. There was a time that I was really going through a difficult time and I moved out of the city. Do you know how many visitors came to see me? One person. And I've had friends who had huge homes. On Sundays, the parking lot was full, even to the road. When they relocated and they moved also out of town, like in 2 years, only 3 people went to see them. So people don't really care. You have to accept and know that the journey I am, people are too busy minding their own business, worried about their stuff. And those who tell you they are proud of you, they're actually surprised that you made it. So for me, I've learned that live your life, do the best you can today.
Mm-hmm.
And I have this motto, even in what I do, if I can reach 2 people, 3 people, and they get encouraged and they are making better decisions, my work is done. Because the other aspect of why there's too much pressure to conform an image, is purely because of our pride. We feel like we deserve better. We feel like we are better than everybody else. And that's the other challenge. Sometimes I like preaching about pride because pride is basically you feeling like you're better than someone else. Yeah.
All right. You know, when you talk about image and people thinking too much, maybe people thinking more about themselves than we think they are thinking about us, you know, I think that's quite a trip. It takes an awakening, right? To as you move to the village, you know, to realize that it's more about me. I mean, people don't really care so much about me.
Yeah.
Now, there's somebody right now who is watching this and they are panicking. Why are they panicking? They are panicking because they've made a series of unfortunate decisions.
Yes.
They are panicking because they are turning 40.
Yes.
And they have nothing to show.
Mm.
They are panicking because they are now turning 50.
Yes.
And life, it seems to be not yet financially begun. They are panicking because they are in their 70s.
Yes.
And they don't seem to have any financial accomplishment to talk about.
Yeah.
Speak to these people.
I get excited and I love such stories. Because in my 16 years, the people that I've met in that position, 2 years, 3 years down the line, they look back and they tell me, you are right. There was nothing to fear. There was nothing to panic. I tell people this. At the end, you know, those, a lot of guys who've done philosophy, there's that description of death and there's the whole topic about death. And death being a very final, you know, it's very final. You're gone, you're gone. And philosophers will tell you that at the end, you realize that there is really nothing to your life. There is nothing. So I tell people, if you're in that position, whatever crumbles, let it crumble. Because what you're focusing is on that big picture of shame, of loss, of everything you feel like you're losing. But in the first place, none of us was born with everything, anything. The great Alexander the Great, when he died, after so many years of fighting, he realized, I'm growing tired, and my all I can think about is my mother, 700 kilometers away. So even the instruction he gave towards his death was that I want my legs and arms dangling outside my coffin. I want the pavement to my grave put, all my gold put, because to signify that my hands are, I came in with nothing, I have nothing. My wealth has been put on the pavement towards the grave. And guess who carried his coffin? His physicians. That even the best doctors could not save him. So what I'm trying to say is, at the end of the day, we cannot be attached to wealth. Some of us will die poor, some of us will die wealthy. But at the end of the day, it is not what, very few people remember their car on their deathbed. You get. And I tell people, there's this DJ who committed suicide. She was called DJ Lithium. He used to work for Capital FM, isn't it? But what happened? Who's the owner? Who was the owner? The late Kirubi. Now, sometimes I imagine if the two met in the lift, and they decided, if it was possible, hey, me, I'm tired of this life. And the Chris would tell him what? Oh, give me that life. You understand? Are you seeing how life is interesting? So whether you're going through a difficult time, whether you feel like you're giving up, let me tell you something. That is just a distraction. The time for taking off, you will not even see. You look back and see there was really nothing to worry. So I'm just encouraging, and I'm interested. They can reach out. I like hearing these stories so that I can remind them in future. Just to as an example, I may not mention the name. This person came to me. They were in mortgage debt. They were being threatened in their marriage. Their husband had taken two loans. With the matatu, they were in a SACCO loan, They were in a credit card. They were in a Shylock loan. And this person, they had good income, but they were even looking older. But I told them, we're going to do a surgery.
Mm.
Even that mortgage, we're going to look at how it can balance everything else. Today, she even looks like she's way younger than she looked.
Mm.
And she says, surely there was nothing. My problem was my pride.
Mm.
And once we put it down and we're able to ask God, what is it that I need to learn now? Because here you're just looking at the image.
Mm.
You're going to be fine. I can tell you, I've been there.
Mm-hmm. All right. Amos, yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For such great insights. And you're quite an encourager.
I've been there.
it's just amazing how you've undone that panic thing. We appreciate it very much.
Yeah.
Especially at this particular time when things are tough.
Yeah.
And to hear that, you need not worry.
Mm.
Just take a deep breath, you know, get perspective.
Yeah.
And you will, and there is help, you know, when you need help, because sometimes we need emotional competence, as you say, the help is available.
Yes.
So thank you so much for such great insights. And I'm sure that our viewers have gained something significant.
Yeah.
The young, the middle-aged, and the old have gained something from your insights here.
Yeah.
And again, thank you so much. We've been talking to Amos Angahu, who is the director of the Money Clinic. And it's clear that the moment you take time, not just to make money or think about making it, but take some time to actually learn what it is, how it works, the mechanics, you will go ahead, because there's such a thing as money knowledge. This has been Spotlight. Thank you for watching.